All right, we're live on Facebook, we're recording. I'm gonna play the intro video and then David will take over for the introduction. Here we go.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's presentation sponsored by the World Affairs Council of Greater Reading, entitled U.S. International Broadcasting, The Voice of America. Our presenter today is Ross MacCallum. Ross will offer us a history and current day perspective on VOA's role in international TV, radio, and social media, and his specific role in the Voice of America's various language groups. Ross has over 25 years of experience in TV news production, news personnel management, and training. He was a key player in the conversion of VOA's TV news from analog to digital news production. He developed and implemented the training procedures used to convert over 24 international language groups at VOA into cohesive users of the new technology. Ross holds a BA in speech communication from Penn State, is a consultant to Voice of America, and significantly hails from Reading. Ross, it is a pleasure to have you with us this afternoon, and we welcome you. The floor is yours.
All right. Thank you so very much. And graduate of Penn State and Wilson High School, actually, as long as we're mentioning, you know, the Reading connections, et cetera, and so forth. So what, just in general, really quickly, you know, I'll just fill in a couple of stray data points of me before I jump into the screen sharing and the actual so-called presentation, is that I have been with a company called HA Design LLC out of Springfield, Virginia since 2009. And they are an operation that works primarily with government agencies to broadcasting entities, and not just the federal government, but also with various state and state-like agencies. We've worked with PBS, National Public Radio, et cetera, and so forth. We're primarily an engineering firm, and we create control room structures, master control structure, et cetera, and so forth. And then we work with the users on how to utilize that equipment. So the training occurs, you know, at various stages. And in many cases, with some of our clients, has been ongoing for years. I mean, just one project rolls into another. We began working on the current project at the Voice of America to switch them from analog to digital television in the summer of 2009. So it's been almost 13 years to the day that we first began there on this project that has continuously built upon itself, because as we all are very well aware, digital technology literally outdates itself the moment that it hits, you know, it winds up in use. 1 second, you push something out, and 10 minutes later, somebody says, hey, the 2023 version is available. Oh, good grief. We just trained everybody on the 2021, and we're going to wind up skipping the 2022, and we're going to vault into 2023, et cetera, and so forth. Now, the project that I'm actually physically assigned to work with at the Voice of America began, as I say, with the idea that we were going to take them from analog television to digital television. And what that meant basically was, for those loosely familiar with TV, we were going to pull them away from videotape and bring them into the concept of digital recording, digital editing, digital playback on all kinds of platforms, including now platforms that we couldn't have even seen when we began just 13 years ago, let alone what they may have envisioned when they first probably began moving in this direction, probably in the early 2000s. They attempted to launch into digital on their own, and they had some difficulties, and we were brought in as a kind of an outside partner to work with them on this. And we were successful, I won't say instantaneously, but we did get a hold of the situation, and we kind of gave it the shove that was necessary and the direction that was necessary. Myself and a number of colleagues over the years, presently I work with three people who are associates of mine. They are not the original three people that I worked with on the project. I've been, the people have come and gone, and certain areas of expertise in terms of personnel have come and gone over the years. And we're sort of in a nice little setup right now where we have sort of like a perfect little group of people that can keep managing the situation and pushing it forward as necessary, covering what we think will be all of the bases, at least in the technology that we can see now. Obviously, there could be something as a surprise on the horizon. Let me just share my screen now for a second. And let's see here. I don't do a lot of Zoom, so forgive me for a second here. Come on, there we go. All right, let me minimize you. There we go. So now I can see exactly what's everything's going on here. All right, so the agency structure in the federal government for United States international broadcasting has changed through the decades. And it's existed for in some way, shape, or form for 80 years now. But this is its current layout under what is known as the United States Agency for Global Media. This is its current name. It's been under a couple of different names over the years, and in some cases has been controlled by different government agencies, including the State Department and the old USIA, the old United States Information Agency. But in the last several years, it has merged into a group called the U.S. Agency for Global Media that is overseen by a chief executive officer who is appointed by the President of the United States. Currently, that job is technically open. There is an acting CEO in place on behalf of the agency, an individual who has been with the agency for, longer than I've been associated with them. And she is currently directing the agency on behalf of the current administration in the White House. The White House has the privilege of appointing a CEO, but has not yet done so. And this is not completely uncommon. The agencies have typically moved from having somebody at the helm to an acting individual at the helm to another one. And things can be turned upside down with the change of any administration. During the pandemic alone, dating back to 2020, we had two separate CEOs and I think two separate acting CEOs, and that's all gone down in the last 2.5 to 3 years. So it can be a position of upheaval, to say the very least. And even though I think people would argue that it is largely a non-political position, there are sometimes aspects where politics do play a role in that. Currently, there are a number of what we call the sisters who are associated to the U.S. Agency for Global Media. The one that I am associated with, I have at the top of the list, that is the Voice of America, and it is the oldest of the sister groups here. In addition, some you may recognize, some you might not recognize. I think most people have heard of Radio Free Europe and its partner Radio Liberty, which is based in Prague in the Czech Republic right now. Radio Free Asia, which is in Southeast Asia. Middle East Broadcasting Network, which is interestingly based in Springfield, Virginia, and broadcasts out of there. It's sort of a breakaway group from the Voice of America, targeting more directly the Middle East, the Middle Eastern countries. And of course, one that you may also be familiar, sometimes euphemistically known as the Office of Cuba Broadcasting Radio and TV Marti. They are based in Miami, Florida, and their priority is dealing with listeners inside Cuba itself. And so that is the basic layout of the USAGM, the United States Agency for Global Media. And now I'm going to focus on the one agency, generally speaking, and the history of this agency that I'm associated with, which is the Voice of America, which is based in Washington, D.C., and in offices down on Independence Avenue in Washington, D.C., not far from the United States Capitol. So the Voice of America itself is the oldest of the sisters, so to speak. And logically, you can, if you saw what the targets were, a number of these things, you know, evolved as various necessities. I mean, until Cuba fell under communist dictatorship, there was no need for radio or TV Marti. Until there was an Iron Curtain post-World War II, there was no need for Radio Free Europe. And so Voice of America, though, is the oldest, and it was founded in 1942, in February of 1942, specifically in response to World War II Nazi German propaganda. And so its initial target was obviously reaching itself into Europe, into the countries that were occupied at the time by the Germans. So the original broadcasters would have been conceivably speaking German, Czech, Polish, Dutch, French, and other related languages. I'm not quite sure of the history of all the individual languages, as some have started and stopped over the years. Obviously, in this day and age, there is no German-speaking group still broadcasting into Germany. There's no Czech any longer. There is no Polish group any longer. The French language is still used heavily. However, it is targeted at Africa, to the former French colonies in Africa. Now, the Voice of America is funded by the United States Congress, but it operates independently behind what is known as a journalistic firewall, and I'll explain that a little bit later on. The bottom line of the Voice of America is that it's committed to the concept of free press, comprehensive news reporting, and basically just getting the truth out there. And they have the ability to do this, and they target this 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. Some of the people have described what is going on here as there is a war of words, in effect, going on around the globe, and we are simply a piece of that puzzle, sort of fighting our aspect of the war as best we can to push out the truth in terms of what's going on internationally, in, you know, not just inside the United States, but also the truth about what's going on inside the United States, and sometimes that means warts and all. So there is an ongoing discussion in programming that has revolved around, you know, gun issues, abortion issues, that sort of a thing. The journalists who are working at the Voice of America are not told to stay away from any negative news about the United States. They simply are simply, as always, required to provide balanced and truthful reporting. Now, the Voice of America broadcasts, as I said, every day. Right now, I believe the total is correct here. I think it's 47 languages. I have the plus there because we actually added a language in the last 2 weeks to a remote area, a language that serves a remote area, I believe, somewhere along the Pakistan-Afghanistan border in mountains, in the mountain regions there. And so that number sometimes floats up and down. There was a time not spectacularly long ago where the Russian service was being scaled back dramatically. When I first arrived, there was not a heavy emphasis on broadcasting in Russian. That has changed dramatically for obvious reasons over the past, well, probably really the past 8 years since the Russians retook what they claim to be their property in Crimea, which is up for debate with the Ukrainian people, and now obviously with the war situation inside Ukraine itself, Russian language and Ukrainian language broadcasting has just simply shot through the roof, as you would expect. We reach approximately 300 million listeners and viewers and other users every week. And that's around the globe. And that's based on research that is done on behalf of the United States Agency for Global Media. I just have an example of some of the languages that we do use. And I started off with English, French, Spanish, Russian, Ukrainian, because that sort of is the obvious. But they branch off into many, many languages and dialects and sub-dialects of languages: Hausa, Bambara, Ndebele, Creole, Mandarin, Cantonese, Chinese, Tibetan, Urdu, Kurdish, Bangla, Khmer, Amharic, Farsi, on and on and on and on. And they're reaching key areas or areas that they feel are underserved by news providers who are truthful in nature. And one of the things you'll notice as I drift through here is that there will be, it's not just a matter of targeting governments that we do not agree with, the Russians, the Iranians, the North Koreans, the Chinese. It's also reaching into countries, some of whom are our allies. Urdu is targeted to Pakistan. We have a Turkish service, and yet they are a NATO ally, but we're broadcasting in their language into their country because we effectively don't trust that all of the news that is being provided in Turkey to be truthful and free, and a free press. So there is a lot to be considered here. And then sometimes that touches nerves because they are aware of what we are doing. And sometimes we're also looking for, in the Turkish area, the Kurdish listeners, and the Turks and the Kurds are not exactly on the best of terms. And so that's something that we have to always be aware of in our work. Now, at the Voice of America, television is done both live and in recorded replay. And it's a wide range of programming: news, talk shows, entertainment programming, actually, some sports programming, although on a very limited basis because there's very heavy controls over sports, as you would expect worldwide. Documentary programming is done. They've just won some very important awards recently for some recent documentaries that were released looking at refugees around the globe. They did a very interesting video on it. Was titled "A Day in the Life of a Refugee," and it was shot simultaneously in about a half a dozen locations on the same day in, you know, six different parts of the planet, and then blended into a single story. It was a very interesting concept and took a great deal of coordination. We deliver our product by satellite, in some cases direct to viewers and or to client TV stations who work with us and include our programming in their daily programming. And there's other ways that we deliver materials as well. Radio is sent out both in medium and shortwave. Medium is basically AM radio, and typically is delivered to most commonly delivered to a client radio station. Shortwave is more the old school concept of reaching the individual with a shortwave radio. As you may have done as a kid, I had a shortwave radio as a kid, and in fact, I still have it sitting in the basement, but I have not used it in years. And we're also working with more modern delivery methodology, podcast, reaching out direct for materials that go to mobile phones. We're utilizing very heavily social media, most notably Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, and probably some things that I haven't even really been heavily involved in. We offer video streaming services. It's something called VOA Plus. It's the same kind of a concept as Peacock on NBC or Netflix, your ability to effectively watch video, in this case, Voice of America programming on demand. And we're also providing something called Polygraph, which is a fact check. And it fact checks everything, primarily the news provided by other services globally. And also it fact checks USA news as well. And they are, and they're capable of even fact checking Voice of America where necessary. And it's just an independent group of people with, you know, under the flag of Voice of America, who are monitoring what is being reported and casting that news against the light of what reality is. And one other service that has been ongoing for decades, and in fact, the number of people who work at the Voice of America first came to be connected to the Voice of America through learning English programs. There's a number of both TV and radio and other programs that simply go about the business of teaching people how to speak, read, and read English. And this has been going on, as I say, for decades. And there are people I've worked with who tell me that the very first experience they had with English was in their home country, listening to the Voice of America on radio, most likely, and learning English that way. And this project is ongoing and is a very important aspect of the mission of the agency as well. So I know, and I've had this, my mother was one of the first people to ask me this, how come I've never heard of where you're working? And I said, well, there's a reason for that. The 1948 Smith-Mundt Act directly prohibits the Voice of America and other now existing USAGM agencies from broadcasting or distributing content directly to a U.S. domestic audience. And the concept, and this came up because of the fear of the way that the Nazi government basically grabbed the hearts and minds of its own people and influenced them into the problems and atrocities that took place throughout the late 30s into the mid 1940s. And the Smith-Mundt Act was designed to prevent that from happening effectively to us. So by doing so, the Voice of America is outward facing. There is no specific delivery methodology to present it to people living in the United States. Now, obviously, the invention of the internet challenged this law at its core and made it impossible to not, you know, have American access to the broadcasting that was provided by VOA and its sisters. So around 1912, a modification was made to the Smith-Mundt Act to make it legal for VOA and other entities to distribute content in the United States on request. And that's the important key word. It's on request. So another agency, another news organization, other groups that could be diaspora groups of, say, Somalis living in Minnesota, or other groups who would like to see some of the programming that is actually targeted to their home countries, can make a request directly to the Voice of America. And on a case-by-case basis, video can be released to them and provided to them. But the modification still prohibits Voice of America and the others from producing content directly for the domestic audience. So there is no, that's why you don't have like the Voice of America channel among your cable choices, but you do see the BBC, you can see China Central Television on some cable services, you can see Russia Today, and you can see Deutsche Welle, the German broadcasters, and on and on and on and on, if Comcast or the other or Verizon or whoever distributes television to you is in some type of a relationship with them. But you'll notice that there is no separate channel for Radio Free Europe. There's nothing for Radio Liberty, Radio Free Asia, Voice of America. Everything is out, still outbound. But at least, and oh, I should mention too here that it was all through this time, though, despite Smith Mundt, it was never illegal for an American citizen to listen to Voice of America programming or watch Voice of America programming and tell other people about it. That was always legal, but it was very, very difficult to do so because of the fact that the agency was prohibited completely from distributing inside the United States. So the Voice of America is a legal entity. The VOA charter itself was signed into law in 1976 by President Ford. The VOA charter includes a journalistic code that everyone associated to the agency has been required to read and effectively sign off on. And the main values of it are balance, accuracy, objectivity. Those are probably the three key words. There's a lot more to the VOA charter than just those three words, but from a news perspective, that is what they target and push. The journalists and other people associated to the agency to do this. And they include, even though I was not an actual journalist with them, we have all been required to review and sign off that we received a copy of the charter and so that we understand, the rules of the road, so to speak, balance, accuracy, objectivity. Now, the 1994 U.S. International Broadcasting Act additionally protects the Voice of America's editorial independence, and this prohibits U.S. government interference. Now, I'm sure that people will tell you that there's ways to get around anything, and that obviously if a president wishes to place an individual in charge of an agency that, with a political agenda, things can happen. Things could happen. But the individuals are protected from any type of retribution or anything along those lines. So if they simply, stand their ground, behind this, the VOA charter, I didn't mean to do that, then everything should be good. But the bottom line is that no government agency can effectively walk in the door and say, hey, I don't like what you're doing. You must change. Now, they can complain like any other listener or any other viewer. So somebody on Capitol Hill can say, hey, I don't like what we're saying. It's like, well, come on, you can come on the TV program next week and we'll discuss in a balanced conversation with you what is wrong or, what you think can be done. But there may be people who will be on that same program who will disagree with you. So, and this completely allows for the Voice of America to be an independent entity in a journalistic sense. Okay, what do I do? What do I specifically do for the Voice of America? Well, I talked a little bit about it up front, but our primary target with the Voice of America is consulting, training, troubleshooting, testing, validating. And those are a lot of vague words, but there's a whole lot of different aspects of what we do. Now, from a television standpoint, what I do is I'm primarily, when the consulting and training is where I'm working really directly with the language service groups. Now, as I said, there's like 47 plus languages that are in play right now. Not all of them are independent language service groups within the agency. French to Africa, for example, has a couple of dialects that are spoken in former French colonies, sort of under its group. Bambara is one of them, for example, but that Bambara just recently, earlier this year, became its own independent language service within it, primarily targeting listeners via radio and social media. So we work with the language service groups, and each language service group has obviously an area of the world or areas of the world, to focus on, and they create programming that is targeted to provide information that might be very heavily needed. So one of the areas of the world that we heavily target is Africa itself. And that's probably where the vast majority of the various languages are spoken, because there's 55 or 56 nations right now on the African continent, with South Sudan's birth a year and a half ago or so. And so, and we're hitting in some level all of those countries, particularly the non-Arab countries, because Middle East Broadcasting in Springfield is probably more heavily targeting the North and Northeast African nations that are seen as Middle Eastern countries as opposed to African nations, despite being on the African continent. So we're hitting Africa daily in English, French, Portuguese, and then in the various other languages such as Hausa and Bambara and Somali and Shona and Ndebele that go into Zimbabwe and on and on and on. And various programs are developed, and they also target certain key areas of communication. Many Africans carry cell phones. So a lot of what's being done is targeted reaching the cell phone users in those countries with their thing. We're also still reaching them very heavily with various radio broadcasts and, of course, various television broadcasts. And what I'm doing in the background then is I'm working with the language service groups. I have no say over the content of their programming. I'm not concerned with what specifically they are telling the users, or the folks around the world in terms of news content, but I'm helping them understand the digital television technology that they're utilizing, and also news and video production methods that will enhance that production for them as they move forward. And it involves a whole various gobbledygook of words like digital asset management, TV graphics creation. We're working with them at every step of the way, editing video. We help them with the Adobe Premiere editing processes. There's also an editing process that's actually built inside the digital asset management system that is utilized as well. So, but Adobe Premiere is a very common, you know, technology that is used globally and very heavily inside United States television. So if you walked into a TV station in the US, you would very likely see some of the same technology that we're utilizing. So one of the other things we do too is we test and we validate and we troubleshoot new digital production systems and tools and workflows as they come into existence. So if Adobe pushes out a new product for 2022, we will get that product, work with it, and see how easy it will be to transition from the current Adobe product to the new Adobe product, see where the improvements are, what's different, what's new, where there are problems. And we have found problems that we've reported back to some of these other creators of these products to say, hey, this doesn't work right. You need to, you know, we're actually helping beyond the walls of VOA by getting back to them. And then we'll turn around and when needed, we'll introduce these new tools and workflows to the VOA users. And this is one reason why the project that began in 2009 is still running 13 years later, is that, as I kind of mentioned earlier, technology is constantly in motion. So the 1 second you show somebody the new anything, somebody else is inventing the newer of the same thing, or some competitor is pushing out something that is allegedly, you know, 5-10 times better. So that's what we're working with. And we're working, and we work with the people both in respects, you know, right down to, in some cases, sitting with them at their desks, at their very, you know, at their desk workstations, and just working with them and talking with them. We're also involved in TV control room settings, as the photograph sort of suggests here. And we're also obviously, and largely driven by the pandemic, we're working with a lot of remote training tools and the ability to meet with people, which also remote training has also allowed us to meet with larger groups of people at the same time. So we have, rather than meeting with, finding a meeting room that holds 20 people and then holding five meetings to meet with 100, I can meet with those 100 people in the same 30 minutes. So what are some of the issues that Voice of America is facing here in 2022? These are common issues that are global. And we're obviously facing things like censorship and frequency jamming and limited access to the internet, hacking, detention and arrest of people who perform work for us globally. So censorship is, as an example, right now, and you'll notice that one of our allies, Turkey, is on that list because they are blocking our ability in some cases to report news, particularly as it relates to the Kurdish issue inside Turkey. And so sometimes you're playing games with your own allies in a certain sense here. The Russian is making more sense because the Russians are censoring news from global agencies, not just simply the Voice of America. They're doing the same thing to BBC, Germans, and other Western broadcasters in basically preventing us from reporting on the special military activity that is going on inside Ukraine, because the Russians are basically being told something else is happening there. And that, in a nutshell, they're being told that the Ukrainians are the rebirth of the Nazi Germans and that they are threatening the Russians living in and along that area, and we're threatening to attack Russia. That's basically what they're being told. In the meantime, their country is doing everything it can do to overrun Ukraine, a country that it, up until recently, recognized the existence of. Frequency jamming, this is an issue with satellites most commonly. The Iranian government is notorious for this. We're attempting to reach out via satellite into listeners or viewers inside Iran. They are doing what they can to make it impossible for us to do that. And they'll broadcast something on the same frequency effectively as it comes down, effectively destroying our ability to reach them. So the game is played that we're constantly moving the broadcast frequencies so that on any given day of the week, we're someplace else. Because I guess the game is that you can't block them all, because then you'll wind up blocking yourself. And so Iran obviously needs the satellite delivery into its remote areas. And so they have to run the risk of possibly jamming themselves, trying to jam us. Limiting access to the internet. This is a common situation, most notoriously in China and North Korea, seen much more recently and heavily in Russia as part of its censorship campaign, by denying users the ability to see Twitter and Facebook. China has gone so far as to create its own internet of sorts to compete with it, to give the Chinese people the idea that they have access to the internet, when in reality, they're simply looking inside their own walls. And as I say, the North Koreans, the classic hermit kingdom, are really, doing everything they can to prevent any type of news or information from penetrating into that country, despite our best efforts to get news and information in the Korean language in there, utilizing South Korea as obviously the launching point for that. Hacking, obviously, that's a problem on a whole boatload of levels. I mean, even personally, you have to be careful that you don't become a victim of hacking, let alone by the government. But obviously, the Russians, the Chinese, the North Koreans would prefer that we had problems and had difficulties that they could create. And we are constantly on defense for this, for any attempt to penetrate our firewall, to prevent damage or our inability to broadcast or provide news and information. And detention and arrest, this has been most common in China recently, particularly in the Western Uyghur region of China, where reporting on effectively reporting on people being placed in detention camps by the Chinese government. They have also obviously targeted not just Radio Free Asia or Voice of America reporters, but if they've made arrests of individuals like that and made it difficult for them to be able to broadcast, or if not actually physically arresting them, the threat that you might be arrested or placed under some type of detention or house arrest or monitoring around the clock can be quite disturbing. And other countries are involved in this as well, but I think China right now, particularly as it relates to the Uyghur situation in that part of the world, has been particularly on note of that. So that is, in a nutshell, is the Voice of America and what I do, or what I am trying to do. And I can take questions on this now, if we want to move along to that. And but the base presentation has concluded, so I don't know if I should stop sharing the screen.
Yeah, go ahead and stop the
okay.
Sharing, Ross. If anybody else has questions coming in, I think we actually answered Bill's question as part of the presentation, but now's your last chance to get questions in, and David has a few announcements for us.
Ross, great presentation. We look forward to the Q&A. We're just going to break real quickly for a couple minutes to review some upcoming program notes and some announcements. The next official WAC program is a virtual one. It's scheduled for August the 31st. And our presenter will be Michael O'Hanlon from Brookings, who's going to address us on the topic of America's security alliances. Starting in September and continuing at least through October, we will be in person again. We will be held one in September, one in October. Both will be held at Legends Restaurant on the Fifth Street Highway. This is the former Roadway Inn just down the street from where the Fairground Square Mall used to be. Our September and these are both noon presentations. And again, they're both live in person. Lunch will be provided. Our September presentation will be on Wednesday the 14th. Our very own Dr. Randy Newnham from Penn State Berks will address us on how the war in Ukraine has changed the world. And then in October on the 12th, also on a Wednesday, another familiar face to our WAC, Dr. Oya Durham Oskansa, a professor at Elizabethtown College, will be addressing us on the topic of Turkey. It's been a while since we addressed Turkey. There's been a lot in the news of late, so that obviously will be a very timely presentation. I also want to announce that one of our former presenters, Jason Casper, who presented to us, I believe it was last summer, on Beirut, is scheduled to address a group virtually at Park Road Church on Tuesday, July the 19th at 6:30. His topic will be reflecting on his international reporting experience from Lebanon, Ukraine, and the Caucasus region to suggest different frames of reference for American polarization and how to address each one. That is scheduled for Tuesday, July the 19th at 6:30. There is a YouTube link that we can provide our members for that presentation, and we will make sure that gets done. So look for that. My final announcement is membership. Be on the lookout for our next mailing. Membership cards are scheduled to go out later this month. Your membership obviously is our lifeblood. It's what allows us to continue to operate. So please fill out your cards, return them as quickly as possible. And as always, we appreciate your support. So with that, I will turn things back over to Mike to facilitate our Q&A. You're on mute, Mike.
I'm new to Zoom. Thanks. Sorry. So we'll stick with Bill's second question then. Who are the Voice of America journalists? How are they selected?
Well, it's a wide range of situations. And I have, just want to say right out the front, I have absolutely nothing to do with the journalists or the hiring procedures or anything along those lines. In a nutshell, there is a mix of international. There are Americans working there. There are international people that have been brought in principally for their language skills. And in some cases, we've done some things where, you know, you might find some people. It's not easy all the time, simply because, oh, we would like some Farsi speakers. We're just going to drop into the middle of Tehran and hire a couple of people. It doesn't happen that easily. And so there are people, you're looking for people that have the language skills who might already be outside of that particular country, or are not necessarily politically aligned with the regime that is running it. And so they might have, but we also have to be careful with that, because this is not an open opportunity for someone who is anti that government to simply take pot shots every day at that. So they obviously, when they're looking for people, they're looking for a language skill, because the rule of thumb has always been, and I think it's just a bit of an inside joke, is that it would be so much easier for me as a person to help you learn how to do television, you know, at you the Farsi speaker, you the Bambara speaker, you the Hausa speaker, you the Russian speaker, than it would be for you, any of you, to teach me how to speak your language fluently and be able to reach the audience. So we have to, that's obviously language skill is number one. Number two, is their journalistic skills? And a great many of them were journalists at various levels in their countries of origin, either working in newspaper or radio, television, whatever. And so that's a great help to be able to get your hands on a skilled journalist who also speaks a particular language or languages. A number of the folks working in the African services, many of them speak multiple languages, so that they're capable of providing two, three, and four languages, you know, hitting, say, English or French. And then in addition to that, being able to speak Shona or Ndebele or Hausa or something along those lines. And that can be a very important aspect of it as well. But we have brought people in. I've worked with some of them where they have limited background in journalism, and we do work with them. And there's other people working in this. It's not just me, but I'm just working in the TV aspect of it. Here, let me show you. Now, there's difficulties there, because some people who had journalistic skills have come from countries where, if you see what their government channels or their local channels carry. I remember one of the Southeast Asian nations, someone played for me very early on in my career there, just to give me some perspective on who I was dealing with. That this was like, they showed me a newscast, their national newscast from the like two or three nights before. And it looked like we had flashback into the 1950s on American television. It was black and white. It was two men sitting at what amounted to a card table with a poorly painted decorative design on the back that was the logo of the channel. And they read from papers, you know, read handheld paper in front of them and read the news with big, giant, old-fashioned microphones and things like that. And this was something that so I'm talking 2012, somewhere in there, but it was like it was 1952. And so in some respects, we have to keep in mind when we're working with people with the technology that we're in some cases grabbing some of these people by the collar and not just bringing them to the United States and bringing them, but we're dragging them 30, 40, 50 years into the future, technologically speaking. And they're skipping the evolutionary process that we enjoyed. And, you know, it'd be just imagine if you had been in a coma since 1980 and were awakened to see what is now on television today, or how things were today. This is in effect what we're doing to them. So it can be, I sometimes think that, you know, some of this has got to be traumatic initially, that they show up in a country like ours and are suddenly flashed into the future. on a couple of fronts. So we work with them on that. But I have to say one thing that has always amazed me is that I am more aware of international languages now than I ever thought I ever would be. This is so far afield of taking a foreign language at Wilson High School that I know things about languages. I can recognize languages, certain languages as they're written. And I can, because someone was showing me something electronically, we were talking about a teleprompter issue. And I said, well, right there, that's not Urdu. And the guy looks at me like, well, how do you know that? Well, I know Urdu and that's not Urdu. That's Arabic. And I said, I can't speak it, but I recognize it. Yeah. And they're like, and this is stuff that, you know, 20 years ago, if you would have said you'd be having a conversation like this, I thought you're out of your mind. So anyway, but I probably have gone a little far afield there, but the it's a challenge and an interesting challenge, and it's a challenge for them as well.
There were a couple other questions about the reporters, but let me ask Dave Carroll's question. I know you talked about the firewall between Voice of America and the Congress. You talked a little bit about the influence administrations coming in and out. Now, specifically with respect to the interim status of the CEO, is that something there's any concern over?
You know, this is just a personal opinion on this, obviously. The acting CEO, when there's an actor coming into the role, they come from inside, typically. So they know what has to happen. They get it. They've been doing it. They had another role in the agency, a very high level role at the agency. They know what they have to do. And so I think in a lot of cases, the shift into the acting mode is very smooth. It's probably smoother than going into a new CEO, because the new CEO is most likely going to come in from the outside and may not necessarily have a real feel, you know, for what goes on a day-to-day process inside this type of broadcasting, because this is a different deal than working at NBC or ABC or Fox or anything along those lines. And so I think in a lot of cases, it's almost like, oh, we're going to get an acting one. Oh, that's okay. Because I think everybody kind of takes a good deep breath, because they already know this individual personally in a lot of cases, or at least know of them, and they know that they know. And most people I've heard this before about other agencies as well, although my skill that the people that work in the agencies know what their jobs are, and they know how to do their jobs, and no matter who is sitting in the White House, they do their jobs. Because it just doesn't matter who's at camp, you know, or who's running things on Capitol Hill. I got a job to do. I know what I'm supposed to do. I do it. And I think in this case, having an acting CEO is the same thing. They know what the job is. They do it.
It almost feels like it would create disruption, but that's a really good perspective that you're actually getting somebody who's going to maintain continuity and actually know what they're doing.
Yeah.
So you talked a little bit before we started about the move to digital. You said that was one of your first projects here with Voice of America. What has been, and maybe this will probably be our last question so that I can get you out of here by 1 p.m. as promised. What has been the most unexpected or surprising result of moving everything to digital that you've seen within Voice of America?
I think one of the things was, is that I think there was a little concern in the very early days that you had this age issue. You have people who've been at an agency for a long, long time, and now and I've worked in the business long enough where I've been through the process where one day they came and took away our typewriters and sat a computer in front of us. And then they came for the videotape machines and the editors and sat something else in front of us. And that can be destabilizing in its own happy way too. And having been through it, I was expecting more of it. And what was funny was, though, I was expecting more of it from the older crowd in some respects. Although now I'm kind of a member of that older crowd, but at the time you're thinking we may have a hard time dragging some of these guys away from the way they're used to doing things, and that some of the younger kids are going to vault right into this and do that. And I think the surprising thing of it was, is that we had a mix. We had some older folks who were like, yep, let's do this, let's go. And we had some younger kids who were like, they were the sticks in the mud. And why aren't you picking? I was counting on you guys to pick this up. You know, I will say this, it runs the gamut. And I think this is probably true anywhere you go, it runs the gamut. We used to keep a thing on a door in an office, and the sign, it was a sign, and it said, Control C, Control V. That's what the sign said. And it was meant as a reminder to myself and the other three or four, however many people at the time were working with me, that we're going to work with some people who will not understand that, that we may have to run some aspects of computer 101 to get things going, that it's going to take a little bit to get the light bulb to go on for some of the people. And it just always kind of kept you in your place. And that has been true. It was true in 2009. It is still true in some respects today that you do run into some people because suddenly we decide that, hey, this particular group, we need to do TV with you. And they're like, we're all radio people because we were brought here to do radio. And so sometimes there's a little bit of a learning curve again. And sometimes some people are into the learning curve and sometimes they're not into the learning curve. But I think that's true, you know, in any situation.
Yeah. And I imagine we could have some people on the call who would appreciate that Control C, Control V sign. Of course, those being copy and paste shortcuts, yeah, keyboard shortcuts on the computer versus selecting the thing and right clicking the mouse and choosing copy and then doing the thing.
We were just thinking of something simplistic, but I'll still run into things, you know, now some TV terminology has become outdated. We have, and I'll just use the classic example, SOT, which stands for sound on tape. Now there is no tape anymore, but we still use the term in the letters, the word, so we call it a SOT. And everybody in the TV business knows what you mean, but it's an outdated phrase, sort of like saying, let me dial the telephone. You know, it at some point that's not going to make sense to somebody. And
like we are about to have this presentation in the can.
Yes, exactly. You know, or the use of film when you mean video, you know, that kind of a thing. So anyway, hey, I just saw a question. I'll answer it real quick here. Does China have similar outreach? This just popped up on my screen. Russia has Radio of Russia Today. China does have what is something called China Central Television, CCTV, and it is available on some broadcasters here in the United States. Now, some probably don't do it, but almost every country of some size has a broadcasting entity not far afield from what we're doing the exact same thing. The BBC World Service, you know, South Africa does it. The Germans do it with Deutsche Welle. The French have, I think it's Globo TV. I might be getting the French a little mixed up there with another country. I might be confusing them with Italy. And the Chinese and the Russians, and absolutely, and the Japanese do it. NHK, you see that on some channels. Everybody is up to telling you what they want you to know. The trick always is, you know, take everything with a grain of salt, because sometimes it's not what they say, it's what they don't say. And you have to hear, I tell this people all the time, you have to hear what isn't said, because that's where the news is. And that's what I always tell people.
Great, great final thought. That takes us right up to the edge of our time. So thank you so much, Ross MacCallum from Voice of America for joining us today. Thanks to all of our members who joined us today. And I'll just make a reminder that our next presentation is going to be on August 31st, and that'll be America's Security Alliances, delivered to us by Michael O'Hanlon. So we'll see everybody back here then at the end of August. Thanks again for joining today, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.